send him into psychotherapy, Jamiroquai returns with another eye-popping video, and Washington's Sleater-Kinny plays for non-pop teens. Welcome to 1515. Mike Myers, Ricky Martin, Courtney Love, and some bearded 70s kind of guy who turned out to be Jim Carrey were among the army of stars who made their way to the 1999 MTV Movie Awards taping in Santa Monica, California last weekend. The show aired on Thursday night, and here, for those who may have missed it, is a wrap-up.
Are you looking forward to meeting any of young Hollywood? All the actors are here tonight.
I'm completely bewildered by it, actually. It's like, this is it. This is L.A., baby.
It's a little chilly up here.
Yeah, what's wrong with this place? It's like being in Brighton, England. It's like a nightmare.
It's supposed to be L.A. It's supposed to be hot. It's not hot.
All right, so maybe it wasn't the warmest night in the history of Santa Monica, but that all changed when she got inside the 1999 MTV Movie Awards. Hot, hot, hot with a capital H. Why? Great host, great live performances, great acceptance speeches. Take a look.
Okay, my crush on you right now is consuming me. You just better present because I'm going to jump on your head. If you ever rip with people, one of us, break out before you get well rushed. At the Wild Wild World, yo, Cool Moe D. Wild Wild World is Cool Moe D. Now, you're the one.
No, you're the one. You're the one.
You're the one?
No.
Yeah, but small talk's hard.
Ben Stiller said you did fantastic. He said you were amazing. You were great out there. How'd you feel?
Oh, that's nice, because he was the one I was like, you know, you're going to get out there and you'll see Ben Stiller sitting there going.
There's some fine looking in this room tonight, I'll tell you that much. Hey, is that chick from the Ricky Martin video going to be at the party?
I've come over all hot and sweaty all of a sudden.
Dude. You have to brush.
They say there's only one thing better than a good actions. You're making me nervous, though.
That beautiful dress.
Didn't cover an enormous amount of her, though, did it?
Yeah, I tried to get her to go down a slide, but she wouldn't do it.
My homeboy can't rock! Forgot to rock his Detroit style one time!
Well, my ears are still ringing from the Kid Rock. That was loud. And the small gentleman who calls, shouts it out for him.
Joe C, yeah.
Joe C and I got a picture together.
These events in general give me a headache and scare me and make me feel constipated.
You lost to not one but two men, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, I learned that Stephen Dorff is only an inch taller than Anakin Skywalker.
A monster shout out goes to Vivian the hairdresser, to the makers of Parmesan wine. I'd like to give massive props to the pharmacist over at the Brooklyn Heights drugstore.
I guess he must have had some inkling that he was going to win, because he had a very detailed speech prepared.
God bless you all!
Just a few of the many highlights of the 1999 MTV Movie Awards show, which, by the way, is re-airing here all this weekend. Try to catch it. Meanwhile, a major musical surprise occurred last Monday when the demented Detroit duo called the Insane Clown Posse popped up at number 4 on the Billboard pop chart with their new album, The Amazing Jekyll Brothers. Clearly, these guys will no longer be denied, so as they headed out on a triumphant promo tour of record stores, complete with custom-built funhouse, we handed them a video camera, and they sent back this kind of scary footage.
In order to describe the psychopathic asylum tour, you must actually witness it, become part of it to feel it.
Psychopathic riders.
Yeah. It's all about theatrics. In the beginning, our friends here, the psychopathic doctors, will escort us into the van in these straitjackets, where we'll be lifted, shuttled, if you will, to the in-store.
Guys, there they are right there. See them? That's them in that van with that flashing light.
No! Shut up! Out of the street! Shut the hell up!
ICP! ICP! ICP!
Get off!
Once we enter the record store, we will enter into our confinement area, which is the actual psychopathic asylum, where you will see inside, of course, insane clown posse will be signing autographs and tricklets of whatnot.
The man too dope signed this fago model right here. That's right.
Sign my head.
Sign my head too. Sign my fago head.
ICP! ICP!
There have been no fans. Not one fan has showed up. Only juggalos. People that think like us, breathe like us, eat, sleep, and die just like us. This is simply a gathering of the juggalos. This isn't a fan meets the star type of thing.
There are more fans of their fans than their fans are of them.
Woo! Hottie!
How was it? Was it cool?
Yeah, it was bad. Shags called me a hottie. He's like, woo! You're hot. I was like, yeah.
You don't just come in and get a piece of paper signed. What do I look like? Ricky Martin? I'm hanging with the juggalos. No matter how many people are coming, we're there to meet them. Juggalos all over the world, baby!
I was a little afraid, but I know it's only a passing phase. So I decided that I would go and be supportive.
I don't care what critics say. I don't care what people say, what parents say, what legislators and educators and lactose intolerant people say. I don't care about none of that stuff, because we don't believe in keeping it real. We believe in keeping it entertaining. That's what we are. We're entertainers. So when you come to meet the Insane Clown Posse, you're entertained.
Insane Clown Posse's amazing Jekyll Brothers album drops down from number 4 to number 15 on Monday's new Billboard chart. We'll be right back with Daniel Johns of Silverchair, a guy who won fame and fortune with his music but lost control of his life and his health. Stay tuned.
When it comes to just being a person and living a normal life and actually having a life, I didn't for a year.
Promote the Australian trio Silverchair couldn't really hide the fact that lead singer and songwriter Daniel Johns now looks radically different from the way he did as a teenager just a few years back. Swamped by his group's success, apparently, Johns sank into a deep depression and developed an eating disorder that reduced him to a sickly shade of his former self, which, as it turns out, is the general subject of the band's new single, Anna's Song, as in anorexia. Here's the story.
Anna's just used as a metaphor and kind of used as a name for a composite of people just hiding behind an eating disorder.
Catapulted into the rock and roll fast lane before he could even drive, life certainly hasn't been what you'd call normal in some time for Silverchair's Daniel Johns. But the pain evidenced in the very personal lyrics Daniel wrote for Anna's Song, and indeed much of Neon Ballroom, reaches beyond the cliched troubles of overnight success and clutches right at the heart of the emotional problems he's been grappling with for the past few years.
When it comes to just being a person and living a normal life and actually having a life, I didn't for a year.
Daniel's depression and paranoia really began to surface as the band was touring in support of their Freak Show album in 1997. Back at home once the tour ended, on the advice of a therapist, Daniel moved out of his family home and into a rented house. But things took a turn for the worse when he isolated himself to the point where he saw virtually no one and did nothing but write poetry for the first 6 months of 1998.
I didn't want to go in public because I felt I had a lot of troubles with anxiety and had to take medication because every time I left the house I'd think people were had conspiracies and people were after me, and every time I left the house I was going to get beaten up.
And while living alone, away from the watchful eyes of his family and friends, Daniel's eating disorder intensified.
Well, how little was it that you were eating?
Got to a stage where it was pretty little. That when I wrote Anna's Song, when I wrote the actual poem, I was eating like, I don't know, 2 or 3 pieces of fruit a day.
Just fruit?
Just,
that was it?
Yeah, but not very much.
Wow.
Unlike many people who suffer from eating disorders, most of whom are women, with Daniel it had nothing to do with having a negative body image.
It was never about my body because I was always embarrassed about being skinny. I didn't.
So quite the opposite from thinking you're too fat.
Yeah, every time I guess I felt that my life was out of control and it was kind of out of my hands, I couldn't do anything about it. I guess I took control of food intake because it was the only thing that no one could really take charge of.
Is that weird to you, that people just assume that it would be impossible for a guy to get caught up in something like that?
Yeah, because I think the biggest myth about eating disorders is that it's all to do with fashion and it's all to do with fitting a certain stereotype. It's not about losing weight to a lot of people. It's more about just having control. And
how much did you lose? Do you know how much you weighed?
No, I know the lightest that I was like 50 kilograms. I don't know what that is in pounds or anything.
Sure, yeah.
When that happened, that was when I saw a doctor and was told to change or things would get dramatically worse.
Fortunately, things took a turn for the better. The combination of the cathartic effect of writing poetry, the helpful impact of antidepressant medications, and the positive response of his bandmates to the music he'd written all helped draw Daniel out of his seclusion and into the studio, where Silverchair began work on their new album. And now out on the road with Neon Ballroom, Daniel is able to call the shots in his career more than ever, and is keeping things from spiraling out of control. Cynics might suggest that Daniel's newly confessional side serves a promotional purpose as well, but he's got little time for such charges.
I don't care what people think. When you get letters that say you've helped me admit to anorexia and you've helped me get, I was going to kill myself until I heard this album, it makes people that say you're exploiting your problems just seem like such a little speck in the exactly. dirt. You just don't worry about it.
Would you say that you're cured now, that you will be cured in time?
I don't think I'm 100% cured. That would be naive to think that, but I'm definitely on the road to being cured. Definitely a lot better than I've been in the last. So my state of mind at the moment is better than it's been in the last 2 or 3 years.
Just happier.
Yep.
If you or anyone you know suffers from anorexia or any other eating problem, help can be had by calling the Eating Disorders Awareness Prevention and Prevention Hotline at this toll-free number, 1-800-931-2237. You can also find out more by logging on to MTV.com. We'll be back with Sleater-Kinny, the anti-Britney Spears, and the return of Jamiroquai. Don't go away.
I want to give you all the address, and I want you to all come over